behind this PMDSM, you have commodification, decommodification, you have familiarization, defamiliarization, you have a number of options that are very present here. If you look at your gender stake, it could be a good way of introducing what will be protected and what has been decided on the side of domestic work. On the side. And so I think it's open a way of discussion because it could be a new age for SPMDSM. And of course, this new age is not today precise enough. And I turn to two dimensions that could be interesting to explore. The first is, of course, the discussion about the third status. I think you speak about gray zones. You are perfectly right. It should be added that in some discussion, you have gray zones and you have gray rights, gray assets, gray entitlements. And it is the way by which Alain Soupiot deals with social drawing rights. They are intermediate between an asset right and a personal right to social protection, so in between. It belongs to you, but you can use in some specific circumstance. And what should be said is that the gray rights, the traditional rights, the that kind of rights, they are not for gray zones, they are for everybody that could go through gray zones. So here we are beyond the identification of the third stages, but we are in the identification of a specific class of problems, career, complicated, with salary, non salary, and so on. And I think it's a very important dimension that could be a component of the new system. Regarding this, it should be said that in our research, we could discuss often the labor market intermediaries, and of course there could be operators that could connect some rights and some trajectories, some people, but it should be said that the labor market intermediaries could be very ambiguous. Some of them are stabilizing jobs and people, others are dealing with discontinuous work and trying to avoid taxation and so on. So it's interesting maybe to connect gray zone operators with gray rights, and there is something that could deepen the discussion. And my last point will be, Sandrine, on segmentation. Of course, if you protect a specific group, anyhow, when you define it, if you have someone belonging to the group, okay, it's protected. If you are out of the group, it's no more protection, there is no more protection. And of course, you build segmentation here. And you have two kinds of segmentation. It has been remarked by somebody I like to underline. You may have segmentation because you have specific way of organizing work, and it is on the work side. And you have segmentation on the opting-in or opting-out on the voluntary side, on the other side. You may have both dimensions and segmentation. And I think that these dimensions lead to the approach you presented. And not only a universalistic approach, because in Sweden they don't feel protected, so you have to go beyond, to have collective organization, to have groups, to have a bottom-up initiative. And it's the reason why I would like to underline that your last sentence, when you say, okay, there is no one size fits all, but it's a complex matter. Well, it is not any kind of combination of complex elements. There are elements, fighting, segmentation, organizing, workers in a specific way. So it's not relativistic, and the last tone of your sentence was too much, okay, it's a complex matter, everybody can find something. No, it's not like this. You have new priorities that will be taken into account.
Can I, that we have some time to react? Okay. So we plenty of questions and comments.
Thank you a lot.
Oh, for both of you for your comments and questions. Just a quick attempt to answer, and you will see the floor. The first reaction from Sandrine concerning the lack of consideration for the segmentation of the labor market. It was not the aim of the exercise, of course. We
perfectly know that we have to consider skilled workers and non-skilled workers, dependent, economic dependencies, and not, and so on. This was exactly the aim of the survey that was presented before, and showing the diversity of situation, of individual situations. But here the exercise was to say, okay, are we able to consider the institutional context, so the macro level, and do we see or not certain links between this, the regulatory framework or the strategies from the unions and so on, and what can be offered in terms of social protection. But we perfectly understand that, and both of you insist on that it's important to focus on the feeling of being protected. And feeling of being protected is of course linked to the economic dependency, to the skills, to the gender issues, to plenty of factors that make the concrete labor market segmentation. And of course we are perfectly aware of that. A question concerning the way in which we present the social protection. So there are plenty of ways for presenting that. In the full document, and maybe we must add that all the documents produced in this project will be available on the website of the project. So you can go there and have a deeper reading of our documents. But the way in which we tried to present the level of social protection was, of course, you can have huge tables with plenty of rights, sickness rights, pension, maternity leave, unemployment allowance, and so on, and it becomes very quickly unreadable. So we opt for a very simplistic categorization. And it was presented by Laura saying, okay, we have the universalistic option, so everything, the full package. So you have access to the full social protection. Second possibility, you have the opt-in system. So you have access to the full package, but it's not compulsory. So part of this package are just accessible if you opt for that. So may create some inequalities or some discrimination between workers. And then you have a third situation in which some parts of the social protection are not accessible. So you are excluded. You are not allowed to even by option, by an opt-in system. So there's three main categories. One, where an attempt to simplify the presentation of the social protection and to offer a broader view about that. A few words about the fiscal support. We are very concerned by the fact that in many countries, the development of new self-employment is supported by the government via fiscal measures. It's especially the case for the moment in Belgium, for example, in which the current government tries to, they say, encourage the development of the new economy and so on, and that's only via fiscal measures. And we want to highlight via this exercise that this is not the right answer. Maybe that it can help the development of the business, of course, but it doesn't offer anything in terms of social protection, and it can inversely increase, and it is there are perverse effects, and it can, to a certain extent,
encourage the black labor market, as it's the case, for example, now. So that's the reason why we wanted to highlight this this question of fiscal budget, because in many European countries, for the moment, the tendency of the policy makers is to adopt this kind of measures. Another question about the social dialogue. You were perfectly right that we have to take into account other dimensions. And of course, it's very difficult to characterize the other dimension. Or assumptions when considering the union rate and the level of coverage was that it could create something like a social norm for the labor market. So when you have a very high coverage rate, it means that the hypothesis was that it could create a driver towards a social protection, even for those not in the standard employment. And we were not able to find this connection. So it was the idea that high level of coverage is not a guarantee for self-employment. But you were perfectly right that we had to consider to characterize, to qualify in a more qualitative way the way in which the social dialogue works, and especially by taking into account the emergence of quasi-unions or other categories of factors, and it will be the subject of this afternoon, and we will discuss the emergence of other actors than the traditional actors of social dialogue. Okay, so that's an attempt to answer some and to react to some of your remarks concerning the suggestions from Bernard. Of course, we are perfectly in line with you that we have to adopt a more dynamic view on that, and this is an evolving picture. And we know that, for example, in France, because you come from France, the landscape is currently under strong evolution. So it's a picture at a certain moment of the time, and it's, of course, it needs to take into consideration the dynamics of the system. Concerning the remark about Anderson's theories, yes, the Nordic model, social model, seems to be better. But don't forget that in our study, we concerning the level of social protection, the full package of social protection is also offered in Slovenia. And Slovenia doesn't belong to the Nordic cluster in the Anderson theory. And you have also a series of countries like UK or Italy and so on that are offering the same kind of social protection, but they belong to different models in the Anderson theory. So it means that we were not able to, you know, just to catch the theory and to apply it as such, but of course we have to go beyond that. As you said, the codification, the familiarization, and so on are very important issues to be taken into account. Just a few words about the transitional rights and the gray rights, what you call the gray rights. I don't like this expression, but I prefer the transitional rights. So the kind of right that you could use whatever your state does, and you can take them, transfer them from a job status to another, and so on. To a certain extent, it looks like what we call the universal system with the opt-in variance. So it's a medium category of social protection. So it's not the worst case, but it's not the best case. So we have to take that into consideration. You want to react on that?
On the grid rights?
Because I think we have to take into account that, it doesn't avoid a risk of growing vulnerability for these people. If it may be based on an opt-in solution. So it means that if you are, if you are belonging to unions or quasi-unions supporting you in your activity, why not? But if you are alone as an individual self-employed, it can enforce vulnerability. Don't you think so?
I think that you have to take the best of both sides, because I think that the universal model needs to have conditional rights too. And so it cannot be divided only on the static basis, couldn't be that anyhow. See, I think the reason why I think that it's not a synthesis from your joints, but it's a common class of problems that could help system to evolve.
Okay. That's a way to avoid the relativist position that we could criticized
in our presentation. Okay, so I think we have some time for debate.
10 minutes for some questions.
Okay, are there some questions or reactions? Yes. I think it could be better to take the microphone.
Thanks so much.
So I'm Carol Murphy from the International Federation of Actors. So the Union Federation representing employers constituted of performers, unions, guilds, and professional associations from around the world. And as you can imagine, representing the constituency of performers, this is an area that's really of key interest, has been a major debate in our sector as well. I was very interested in the presentation, but one of the things that struck me most strongly was when you were beginning the introduction to the section on trade unions, you mentioned the structural factors and the agency factors, and whether or not unions organized self-employed workers was considered an agency factor. But in fact, it's structural, because one of the main barriers to organizing self-employed workers in my sector and across many sectors is the fact that it is forbidden by competition rules. And I think, Sandrine, you put your finger on that, because that has also been tested in at the ECJ level, and it's a very complicated picture, but in practice, on the ground, competition agencies have overturned, in some cases, established collective bargaining relationships covering self-employed workers on the grounds that it was considered to be a cartel. And that has had a significant chill factor on organizing self-employed workers. And I think that to categorize the organizing of self-employed workers as being purely down to union choice is not the answer. It doesn't really capture the challenges that unions face. Another thing that I missed a little bit in relation to the union organizing section, and I think maybe it's something that arises from the difficulty that you described of mapping the kind of iPro statistical category onto the labor market categories. But somehow I think that in doing so, we've missed out a little bit on the sectoral realities, because it was quite clear that the iPro profile is concentrated in a number of sectors. Sectors were listed in the first section screen. And I just wondered whether the specific sectoral social partners in each of those categories were somehow able to feed in and give you more nuance in the picture, because they are very well placed to know how collective representation in their sectors impacts on the situation of self-employed or freelancers or other kind of, you know, hybrid and typical workers. And I'm afraid that in some cases, without that, you can miss entire sections. So for example, in France, I think this kind of macro level has picked out, for example, the micro entrepreneur category and, you know, the gaps that creates, but it misses the whole system of the technicos, which you know, most performers and technical workers in France are within. So in that way, I think you're, and that sits naturally in the hands of the sector of social partners in France and is extended to the whole sector. So I kind of think that some of the insight there on how this specific category of workers clustered to these specific sectors experience trade union representation or not, like, again, it needs to be a bit more nuanced. And finally, I think that there is a wider question of how the low levels of social protection relate to the extremely low income levels. And it's very hard to separate those two things. I think, you know, it's quality of work, and they go together to a large extent. And some of the very specific protections that have been created have been in recognition of the weak situation of, for example, bogus self-employed. But why is the situation of these, you know, supposedly non-subordinate self-employed so weak then in the labour market, to have such an incredibly weak income? And I think that there, certainly in my sector, where we've been able to look at specific experiences where the collectively bargained minimums are removed, for example, this is a very specific example, but in the dubbing sector, there was formerly a system based entirely on employment, dubbing actors were employed, in terms of working conditions, etc. That was very regulated, the pay was quite high. It's no longer the case that there are any collectively bargained minimums in the sector because most dubbers are now self-employed, and technology has meant that if you want to dub something, you can do it at home in a home studio.